So my name is Sushant. I'm a software engineer at Google. I have completed a master's degree in computer science from IIT Bombay. And I have around 7 years of experience, both in software engineering and machine learning.
Okay, so we are going to cover a data structure called UnionFind. This is one of the advanced data structure, but it's not difficult to understand what's the intuition behind this data structure. So this is just outline what I'm going to cover. I'll may not be able to cover all these topics, but I'll let you know what is UnionFind in some basic terminologies. So what is a UnionFind? UnionFind is a data structure that keeps tracks of elements which are split into one or more disjoint sets. It has two primary operations, find and union. So this is just to give you an intuition of how this data structure actually works. So say we have multiple magnets, we have around 14 magnets, and they are scattered across a table or any flat space. And each of these magnets have different force, like some have higher attractions to others, and which are placed closer together, they may get attracted to each other faster than others. So in the first iteration, the 6 and 8 magnet are going to attract each other. So they will get attracted and get joined. So you can see it as a join operation. So it's a union operation. So you are unionizing these two magnets. And we are going to assign a color so that they belong to same set now. So there is no 6 or 8 now. They are just one set. Then 2, 3, 4 are going to attract each other. They are going to join in a orange color. Now 10, 13, 14, they are joining in a blue color. Then 11 and 12, they are joining. Now 9 wants to be part of the blue group because there is some attraction. So it has become a part of blue group. Now there is attraction between yellow group and blue group. They are joining together. They have joined together and it become a part of yellow group, blue group. Now this has become a part of blue group. These two magnets become a part of red. Now one is getting attracted, and in the final step, they are all getting joined together. So this is just to give you an intuition. You will know what was this example for. So UnionFind is used. The major application you will see of the UnionFind is in the Kruskal minimum spanning tree algorithm. It's mostly used in graph-based algorithm like network connectivity. Least common ancestor entry, you use UnionFind. Also some in image processing, also in machine learning, we use UnionFind data structure. So complexity-wise is the one of the best data structure. All the complexity, whether it's a union or find, get component size, all are amortized constant time complexities. You can read about this amortized constant time, but the construction of the data structure only takes a linear time, and all the other operations takes a constant time. So I'm just going to show how to apply this data structure on Kruskal algorithm. So in Kruskal algorithm, you have a data, you have a graph, and you want to find a minimum spanning tree of that graph. Minimum spanning tree is just a tree which is formed from the graph, but which has the minimum number of minimum edges. Minimum edges means that the sum of all the edges will be least. So as you can see, this is the graph. Once you remove some edges, what remains is a tree structure. This is not a graph, this is a tree, because there is no loops. You can see that every component is connected to another component, but you won't find any loops. And if you sum edge weights, it will be minimum. There could be multiple solution. There could be multiple minimum spanning trees, but your task is to find the spanning tree with the minimum cost. So how this algorithm works? This is a pretty easy algorithm, Kruskal minimum spanning tree. What you do is you list out all the edges. You sort those edges by ascending by edge weight. Then you walk through each edge, walk through each sorted edge, look at the two nodes that edge belongs to. So say in this case, you can see that the zero edge have the least cost and it belongs to I and J. So you include that in your set. The algorithm terminates when every edge has been processed and all the vertices have been unified. So I'll show you how this works on this graph. On the left hand side, I have sorted the edges by their cost, and I'm going to include one by one. So I'm going to include first edge because it has cost zero. Then I'm going to include second edge. There is no connection between the first edge and second edge, so I'm going to assign it some other set. So first is our yellow set, second one is our blue set, then a third one is actually connected to a component which is in our yellow set. So I'm going to assign the value yellow color to it, and then E and F is connected to our second set which is blue, so I'm assigning a color blue. Then I'm getting an edge which does not belong to both of the sets, so I'm assigning a color red to it. So these both the nodes have been added to a set called red. Then I'm getting another edge which is I'm assigning color green to it. I'm getting an edge which is forming a loop. So see, there is a loop that is forming there, C and J. So if you see that both of the components, if they are already in some set or in some group, you don't need that edge. So then I'm going to D and E. So now D and E both belong to two different groups. So see what happens in this case. So the group converts its color to blue. So green has become blue now. Then D and H, so it will get connected to it. Now it has become blue. Now A and D, it forms a loop, so we are going to skip it. Node A and D already connected in a purple group. This creates a cycle. So we skip it. Then D and B are already B and C. So they belong to different groups, so they are going to get connected to each other. So we have all the nodes which are blue, and we have got our minimum spanning tree. So that is our minimum spanning tree. So how do we use GNN and find operation here? So what I'm going to do is assign a random vertices a number. So say I have assigned these verticals vertices a number. Then I'm going to make an array which index represents the value. So I'm going to copy the value of the index into the cell of that array. In the initial, the array will look like this. So index will be from 0 to 11, and the values will be also from 0 to 11. So these are the instruction how to unionize. So you want to make a union of C and K. What you will do is just make the value of K to match the value of C. So whatever the value C has, you will copy that value into K. So K and C will point to the same value. That means they are in the same set. So you don't have to actually make a set data structure. You don't have to use the set data structure. It usually has very high complexity when you are adding an element or you are removing an element. So you don't have to use the set data structure. You can just use array data structure and make this modification. So on each union see what is happening. So there is a union of F and E. So you are just going to modify the value of F to make it match with the E. So you are going to keep performing these steps one by one. You are going to modify the values. So each is getting. So in this case, you will say that you don't have to modify the values of A and B because A and B already pointing to J. And if J is started pointing to C, the A and B automatically becomes the part of the C group. So you don't have to actually join the set. So if you are using sets, you will have, when unionizing those sets, the complexity will increase to N into M, the size of the two sets. But here you can get the union of two sets only in constant time. So you just point to C. So this way we can just perform these operations. And in this case, I'm not using path compression. There is something called path compression, which once you, what this does is you're making a union easily, but when you're trying to find, like you're trying to find the set of H, then you have to hop till three. You have to hop four times. Like, see, you from H, you will go to G from here. H from 11, you have to go to 8. From 8, you have to go to 0. From 0, you have to go to 4. And then you will get 4, that when the index and the value match, that you have come to the set. So this hopping, I'm not reducing this hopping. There is something called path compression, which will reduce the hopping operation. So hopping is the find operation. And this is this operation that we are doing now. This is a union operation. So the find operation, to find which component a particular element belongs to find the root of the component by following the parent node until the self loop is reached. So in this case, if you want to find the parent of H, you have to go to G, then E, and then C. See, from the array, you can go from H is from 11, you have to go to 8. From 8, you have to go to 0. From 0, you have to go to 4. And it, at 4, you will see that you have reached a self loop. That means you have found the group of that particular element or set of that particular element. And union operation is to unify two elements, which are the root nodes, each component. And if the root nodes are different, make one of the root nodes be the parent node of other. So yeah, in the set operation, maybe you can do an union of element. Maybe you can perform a difference operation, subtracting one set from other, then you will get an union of that set. But here you won't be able to do that. But this operation is also not required in most of the algorithms that this data structure is getting used. So yeah, this is the problem. If you don't use path compressions, it says here that if we checking if H and B belongs to the same group, it takes 5 hops, and in the worst case, this is potentially much more. So there is something called path compression, which will reduce your find operation complexity to constant time. So in this case, if you are trying to find whether H and B belong to the same group or not, you have to, from H you have to hop 4 step, and from B you have to hop 2 step. So this is increasing your time complexity. So from H you will go to G, E, and C. And from B, you'll go to G and C. Then you'll say that they belong to the same group.